Okay, so welcome everyone. It's my great pleasure to introduce today Nicolai Reshetikhin, right now from Beijing. And he's going to talk about the asymptotic behavior of character measures in large tensor powers of finite dimensional representations of simple algebras. And let me remind you that this talk, as usual, is being recorded and you can watch it on our YouTube channel. So Kolya, the floor is yours. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, Kasia. I'll be talking about the asymptotic of character measures on tensor, large tensor powers of finite dimensional representations of simple algebras. And when I was about sort of in the middle of the preparation, I got a message from Kasia that I should be somehow, I shouldn't forget about physics. And Hal also hinted me that not everyone is here will be an expert in simple algebras. So I followed this advice, and most of my talk will be about SU2, which is related to physics. Okay, so this is based on a joint work with Olga Posnova, who is here, I think. And the plan is the following. So first, I will remind about statistics. Well, I will actually talk about statistics of invariant tensors. In systems with n spin atoms, when n goes to infinity, that's for SU2. And then at the end of the talk, I'll explain a few things about the other simple algebras. So the origin of the problem is very natural. So imagine that you have a lot of atoms with sort of internal degrees of freedoms with spins. So in the simplest case, say you have n atoms with spin 1/2, so that there is an excess of electrons. And the space of state of such system is C2 to the n, where n is the number of atoms. They don't have to be on a chain. It's just a system of n independent atoms where spins can be up and down. Just, you know, the usual spin system. SU2 acts diagonally on this system. So if we have a vector x1, monomial vector x1, xn, then the group element G acts on this vector diagonally. And with respect to this action, it's a representation of SU2, so it can be, SU2 is semi-simple, it's a finite dimensional representation, so it decomposes into the direct sum of several copies of irreducible SU2 modules. So it's the sum of spin L over 2 modules with some multiplicities ML. And the multiplicity, it's the number of linearly independent vectors which transform as spin L over 2 vector or tensor. So it's a well-known fact to many that the multiplicity is given by the difference of two binomial coefficients. It can be proven in many ways. It can be proven combinatorially. It can be proven using the character formula. So I'll outline the proof. I will explain the combinatorial origin of this formula. So then the simplest distribution, Boltzmann distribution on the space of invariant tensors is just basically the uniform distribution on multiplicity spaces. which means it's a planarial distribution on this space of irreducible components. Usually, planarial distribution it comes from the analysis of the symmetric group, but now I think it's widely accepted that it's just can be applied to any finite dimensional representation of something that's act by on it in a simple way. In other words, if you have a finite dimensional representation which decomposes into irreducibles with respect to some group or some algebra, such that it's this direct sum, then the planarial measure is just the following. It's the multiplicity times the dimension of Vi. So it's the dimension of this irreducible component divided by the dimension of W. So this is what in modern language should be called planarial measure. So the question is, how does this measure behave when n goes to infinity? It's a, again, from the physical point of view, it's a very natural system. You have a large system of kind of individual spins. You neglect the dynamics, say the Hamiltonian is zero.
I'm afraid that the speaker is frozen.
Yeah, I thought it was just me. Kolya, are you there?
Of the system.
Yeah, you switched off for a second. So.
Oh, am I back?
Yeah, you're back, but you were out for like a minute.
Oh, okay. I probably didn't say anything important.
Okay.
We'll see. I hope it will not happen. Okay. So, so the theorem, a very simple theorem that, you know, for anyone curious, it's a nice homework. So, as n goes to infinity, if you renormalize the total spin by square root of n, this planarial probability measure converges to to this measure on R plus, and this measure on R plus is, I mean, everyone recognizes this. It's like a spherically, it's a radial part of the invariant measure on the dual space to the Lie algebra. So if you will take SO3 Lie algebra dual vector space, there is a natural G invariant measure there. So you take the radial part of this measure, that's what appears in random matrices, and you will get this one. So this is a kind of nice result, which probably has been known for a while, at least since 1986. The proof is just a very straightforward use of Stirling formula for binomial coefficients and the use of this formula for the multiplicities. Everything else is trivial. Okay, so we know how this measure behaves. So, but now let's switch on the magnetic field and let's consider the quantum density matrix of the following form. So it's e to the h s z, s z is a total projection of the total projection of spin. And then for the normalization, we divide it by trace of e to the hc, so the result is really the density matrix, which is positive and normalized. So now if you have an invariant tensor, invariant linear operator acting on C2 to the n, it decomposes into this direct sum. Because it's SU2 invariant, it, by Schur's lemma, it acts trivially on each irreducible subrepresentation. But it may act non-trivially in the space of multiplicities. So this is what this I forgot to put. So now the expectation value of this quantum observable is just a trace with the density matrix, but because it acts only on multiplicity spaces, we can write it in this way. It's the sum of probabilities that we end up in a given irreducible component. This is the uniform quantum uniform density matrix, just the identity operator divided by the dimension in CML in the multiplicity spaces. And so as a result, we extracted the measure on the space of irreducible subrepresentations of C2 to the n. So in other words, it's the measure on the symmetry types that appear in our tensor product. So now we have the same question as for zero magnetic field. How does this distribution behave as n goes to infinity? And here there are several possibilities. We can fix h, or we can consider various scaling limits. H goes to zero, h goes to infinity as n goes to infinity. So let's first consider a fixed magnetic field. So then, again, if we want to compute the asymptotic of this measure, all we have to know is the asymptotical behavior of the multiplicities, which we already know and which we used in the previous result, and the formula for the character, which we know from any textbook on representation theory. It's this one. So if you put these two ingredients together, you will end up with the following result. The distribution is kind of exponentially sharp. It's like the same phenomenon as when you toss a coin 1,000 times, then it's exponentially improbable that the frequency of, say, coin landing on one side will be not equal to 1/2. So, but if in the vicinity of 1/2, you have a Gaussian distribution. So this is the eta, that's the analog of 1/2 in the example with coins. And also this is something that is known now in statistical mechanics as a limit shape. It's really the limit shape of the representation. In the same way as you have random surfaces, and if they develop limit shape, it means that they develop sharp, most probable kind of deterministic limit surface, and then there is a Gaussian distribution around this surface. And the surfaces that are macroscopically far away from this limit shape, they are exponentially improbable. The same is here, and I forgot to put n here. There are lots of letters here. So this k is just the second derivative of the rate function s when xi is equal to eta. So the rate function is given by this combination, where g is the Legendre transform of the logarithm of the character of the two-dimensional representation. And eta is the critical point of this rate function. The rate function is convex, so there is only one critical point where the function is maximal. The g function is concave, and so everything works beautifully. And really, this is what we have. So we have the probability is exponentially small if our rescaled spin is far away from the critical value, and near the critical value, it's Gaussian at the scale square root of n. So in particular, it means that if we will take a test function of, with this argument, we'll compute the expectation value of the test function as n goes to infinity, it will converge to the expectation value with respect to this Gaussian distribution. So this is the case when h is fixed, and we're considering the character measure on the on tensor powers of two-dimensional representations. And I just want to emphasize that when you consider tensor power of anything, it's an ordered tensor product, this one. But it has nothing to do with ordering. I mean, you can permute elements as you want. It's not a spin chain. There is no Hamiltonian that sort of interacts between nearest neighbors. Okay, so now we consider the limit. So that was the just the kind of regular limit as when h is fixed n to infinity. So now let's consider the scaling limit when h goes to zero and n goes to infinity. And the very particular scaling that we choose is this one. So u now is certain external parameter, that's the intensity of the rescaled magnetic field. B is our rescaled highest weight, the spin of the representation, x some numerical constant that's not really important. And the result is that there's this strange intermediate scaling, which we have between h equals, strictly h equals zero. You can see that if you send u to zero, you will recover u goes to zero, then you recover Planchero. So this is some intermediate asymptotics that occur in this limit. And again, if you take a test function, then this probability distribution evaluated on this test function will converge to the limiting probability distribution evaluated on the same test function. So, I mean, this equality means that in the language of probability theory, it means that our probability measure weakly converges to this continuous probability measure. Very good. So, so now let's we will see some nice pictures explaining this ABC. But now let's just see if anything special can happen as h goes to infinity. Apparently, yes. If h goes to infinity and n goes to infinity, and this combination n times e to the minus 2h is fixed, then our everything is great, but Beijing is very dry comparing to Bay Area, so I'm still getting used to it. So you can see that this probability measure converges to the Poisson measure. But Poisson measure of a different nature. Before, all these measures were continuous measures, and this one is a discrete measure supported on numbers integers from 0 to infinity. So in order to have a better understanding of these scaling limits, let's consider associated lattice walks. So let's denote by V1 representation of irreducible representation of spin 1/2 of SU2, VL irreducible representation CL plus 1 of spin L over 2. So then it's a well-known fact that most of the people here learned at the first year of the university. So that we take spin 1/2 representation multiplied by the spin L over 2 representation, we got two irreducible subrepresentations. It decomposes into the direct sum. So VL tensor V1, it decomposes into VL plus 1 tensor VL minus 1. So this gives the formula how to treat, how to compute V1 to the n. We first take decompose V1 tensor V1. So this will give V0 plus V2. Then the result of this decomposition, we multiply by V1. We again get decomposition, and then again and again. And the result is that we can see immediately from this formula that this multiplicity simply counts the number of lattice walks. So if we start from this vertex, this is the Pascal triangle, the thing that goes to the left and to the right, that's the Pascal triangle. So if you start from this vertex, the multiplicity of occurring this representation, so this axis is L axis, this axis is N axis. It is simply the number of lattice path from the top to our vertex L. It's the number of red paths, the ones that are to the left of zero, because we do have the restriction L is greater or equal than zero. This is where L is zero. So none of the physical kind of path that we want to count, they don't go to the negative part. But so how to explain this difference of binomial coefficients? Very easily, because if we want to compute, so what is the meaning of this binomial coefficient? This is simply the number of all lattice paths descending monotonically from the top of the Pascal triangle to our point L. So now, how to extract from this number the number of paths that are to the right from this dividing line from negative L to positive L? Well, we just have to eliminate the first step. We have to eliminate all possible paths that start from this point and arrive to the point L. We have to eliminate all yellow paths. And you know, I don't want to go into the details of this. It's called a reflection principle. So basically, it says that the number of paths in the positive part of this of the Pascal triangle, which is our multiplicities, is the difference between the these two numbers, which are the numbers of all possible lattice walks, lattice path. So very good. So this is the combinatorial meaning of this formula. So now, when we have this decomposition, we can also interpret it as a stochastic process. We can assign probabilities to transitions. We can say, if we will say that the probability of transition from L to L plus one is the ratio of the dimensions. This is the dimension VL plus 1, 2. Sorry, 10. Which will not affect, fortunately, the result. But this is even worse, which doesn't affect. Okay. So it's dimension V1, dimension VL. So it's this number. And then similarly, we have the probability, transition probability from L to L minus 1. Now, it's clear that we have this stochastic process. And if you run it n times, it induces a certain probability distribution on this line. And this probability distribution will be exactly the Plancherel distribution. So this is another way to think about Plancherel distribution. It's the distribution that is induced by this very specific stochastic process. And you can see that for large L, this stochastic process, it's left-right invariant. The probability of moving to the right is 1/2, and the probability of moving to the left is also 1/2. It's not true for small L, but for large L, it's asymptotically true. So now let's look at the character measure. So naturally, the Markov chain with these probabilities, it will induce the character measure after running it n times. So in some sense, you can think of this Markov process as a universal machine that produces these distributions for every moment of time, for every n capital. And you can also see that as L goes to infinity, this Markov process converges to an asymmetric Markov process. Now the probability of moving to the right to larger values of spins is bigger, strictly bigger than the probability of moving to the left. And so this is what we have. If h is zero, we have this radial part of the invariant measure, invariant Gaussian measure that's fluctuating here. If h goes to zero, n goes to infinity, we have something that's still very close to here. And for the unarmed eye, we wouldn't distinguish between h is equal to zero or h is of the order one over the square root of n using these pictures. But you can see what's happening for finite h. It's a Gaussian process with a drift. The drift is given by these asymmetric probabilities. And the Gaussian process, well, it's a Gaussian process. It's a, something very natural that occur in such systems. So then if h goes to infinity, it's also clear what happens. If h is very large, then the path kind of creates very long very long sequences where it goes to the right. And it can go, say, if this is the it should go to the left only finitely many times. Then it will have finite probability. Otherwise, the probability will be zero. And so this is the nature of this ABC cases. So this I believe that this is A, this is B, this is C, and this was unnamed Plancherel. Okay, so, and I just want to emphasize again that these random walks, they occur in this spin space, in some kind of abstract Platonian space that doesn't exist in reality, but helps us to describe the reality. Okay, so then you can ask what happens if you take the large tensor power of some other representation. Again, from the physical point of view, this is a very natural question. So you don't have to have spin 1/2 systems. You can have larger spins. So in this case, you still have the decomposition. You don't have a nice, you can describe M as, again, as a result of random walk, but more efficient description is through the orthogonality of characters. So we have this nice formula. And then as M goes to N, so again, we still have the character measure. The only difference is that now we have this factor over here that's more complicated than e to the h plus e to the minus h. As n goes to infinity, the integral for the multiplicity can be continued by the steepest descent method. And the rest is very similar to k equals 1. So I'll just formulate the results. So the result for fixed magnetic field as n goes to infinity is the probability, this probability with the magnetic field. It behaves, again, it's a Gaussian distribution around the limit shape. The limit shape has exponentially small everywhere else. The limit shape has the same description. So this k constant is the second derivative of the rate function at the critical point. And the only difference is that the rate function is more complicated. For spin 1/2 case, if you really want to compute eta, you can. It's not difficult. For other spin cases, it's impossible to compute the explicitly this critical point, well, because you have to solve some algebraic equation that doesn't have explicit solutions. But on the other hand, who cares? We know that it exists. We know it's unique because this function is concave. This function is concave. This convex. So we know that there is I switched everything. Concave and convex is opposite. So we know that there's only one point where the rate function is maximal. So just the same as for k equals 1, there are two scaling limits. H goes to 0 with this rate. H goes to infinity with this rate. And just as for k equals 1, you can interpret all these measures in terms of lattice walks, lattice path. The only difference is that every step of the lattice path of this random lattice path, it originates at every step, it originates at L. And if L is sufficiently big, bigger than K, and remember that K is fixed. So we're talking about large tensor powers of VK. So this path can jump to anywhere from L minus K to L plus K. And here the next one will be L minus K plus 2, and they go with the increment of 2. So the same thing, if you want to have we can consider this Markov process. It approaches as L goes to infinity to a Markov process with drift. So this is the asymptotical behavior of this probability measure. So naturally,
Nicolai, can I ask a question?
Yep.
Yeah. So I should have asked this before, but so here you talk about lattice walks and also this stochastic process. So is there any direct connection between this lattice walks and this process L, that L goes to L plus rho?
Yes, it's it's the following. So the multiplicity is the number of this lattice path.
Yes.
But if you want to have a lattice path interpretation of the Plancherel measure, then we can say the following. Let's consider the random process where the path can turn to the left with this probability and can turn to the right with this probability, which is the ratio of dimensions. And then it's a simple theorem that I didn't prove here, but I'm just stating it now, kind of restating it again, that as a result of this random walk of this stochastic process, you will induce some probability measure on these entries. Mm-hmm. It will be the probability of occupation of this point. In other words, it will be the probability that the path will land on one of these points.
Yes.
Uh-huh. And that's exactly the Plancherel measure.
Okay. So that is the case for h equals zero, right?
Yes, this is the case of h. Uh-huh. If h is not zero.
Yeah.
Yes, go ahead.
Oh, no, no. So, yeah. Okay, so you established the connection for the case h equals zero. Yeah.
Yes, but if you're saying that this,
right. I'm sorry. Yeah, please.
Let me finish. So, so if h is not equal to zero, then if we consider this Markov process, where instead of ratio of dimensions, we have ratio of characters, then again, it's a small theorem that on this line, we will have probabilities. It's just the probability that the path will land on this point. And this probability will be exactly the character distribution.
Oh, okay. Is there any corresponding lattice walks for this non-zero H case?
Yes, the combinatorics is the same. Lattice walks are the same. Uh-huh. Only the only probabilities are different.
Uh-huh. Oh, okay, yes. Okay, thank you very much.
Uh-huh. Okay. So now, if we play this game, then the combinatorics is different. So then we can jump from L to several places. L minus K plus 2, L plus K. And again, the claim, the little theorem that I should have stated here, but somehow I didn't, is that if you consider this stochastic process with this combinatorics of lattice walks, then after n iterations of this stochastic process, it will induce the character measure on the corresponding points at level n. And this will be how, this will be the probability of, so this is some kind of version of Pascal distribution. It's the probability of going to the point P from L. So for large L, the probability of going from L to L plus P will be given by this formula. And you can see that it sums up to one, because if you will sum up all these monomials, this is exactly the formula for the character. They will sum up to one, so it's perfect. It's a probability distribution that shows you that turning to the left is very improbable. Then the more you move to the right, the more it's probable. And the most probable is turning to the far right. Okay, so this is the combinatorics for the for large tensor powers of VK. So now what else can we do? So clearly you can see that I'm playing games here. And it's in some sense, this is the nature of the problem. So at some point there was a question how the tensors are distributed in large tensor products, invariant vectors. I'll say a few words about the history. So what else can we do here? We can change the irreducible representation that we, so you see before, I was talking only about this. So we can change this irreducible representation to some reducible representation. Say we have n zero copies of one dimensional representation and one copies of two dimensional and so on. So again, the answer will be very simple as n goes to infinity. Similar technology works. You can also ask what happens if you have an I goes to infinity in the tensor product V1 to the N1, VQ to the NQ. Again, everything is very similar. So this type of system is describes, well, it's clear that this has direct relation to physics. And it's also clear that it doesn't capture very interesting physics because so far my Hamiltonian was very simple. Magnetic field times the projection of the spin. So naturally I want to put here something dynamical. So one can make various guesses. So my guess is that if this dynamical Hamiltonian is uniformly small, well, then you will still have this distribution. So so part of the motivation for this problem came from integrable spin chains when, say, you take XXZ Hamiltonian plus the magnetic field, you might ask the question, what happens is as H goes to infinity? So this is what happens. So anyway, so that was the story for SU2. Any questions about this? Because we will dive into the world of simple Lie algebras in a second. And now it was a physical problem. Now it's a mathematical problem.
there's one comment, yeah.
Yes, please go ahead.
Can I ask? Yes. So was there any physical observation or physical phenomena that people discussed about this XXZ chain?
This question of computing large asymptotic of large magnetic field, it was raised a long time ago when people studied thermodynamics of the XXZ model. I don't think at that time really people studied correlation functions, which is more or less what I was doing here. I'm sure there is some literature about it, but I couldn't find anything.
Okay.
So actually, if somebody will point me to a good place where people are doing something similar on the physics side, it would be very interesting.
Okay, thank you. So yeah, please dive into.
Okay. So now we let's look at the more general case when G is a simple algebra. Every time I say simple algebra, just for simplicity in this presentation, think of this as SLM. And H is a Cartan subalgebra in G. For SLM, these are diagonal matrices. V nu is an irreducible finite dimensional representation of G with highest weight nu. So again, for SLM, for GLM, think of this as a Young diagram. And then we have a question. Say, if we consider V nu to the power n, it decomposes again into irreducible components. Again, let's switch on the magnetic field. But now the magnetic field will be just a real element in the Cartan subalgebra, a real diagonal matrix. So then we have the character measure in a similar way. It's a measure on the support of these multiplicity functions. It's zero where the multiplicity is zero. And clearly this is really a probability measure in the sense that it's one negative and sum of all possible lambdas is equal to one. This is simply the property of characters. So if it's, this should be obvious. And then, well, you know, we know quite a lot about finite dimensional representations. In particular, there is the Weyl formula, Hermann Weyl formula for characters of irreducible representations. So the very first question is, suppose that H is fixed, our generalized magnetic field, n goes to infinity, what is the limiting distribution of invariant tensors? So there is some history of this problem. A similar problem, but not exactly this one, for the Planck-Schirrell measure on Sn, was analyzed by Vershik-Kerov and by Logan and Shep before this work. But it was truly in the context of the symmetric group. So what Kerov did is he looked at the decomposition of Cn to the power n as n goes to infinity, used the sure-wire duality, and he computed the asymptotic of the Planck-Schirrell measure, and he discovered that this Planck-Schirrell measure converges to the radial part of the invariant measure on the dual space Dilly algebra. So then in 1993, Philippe Bien, he studied the asymptotics of multiplicities for tensor powers of irreducibles for any Lie algebra. So this work was extended by Tate and Zeldich in 2004. So they also connected it to the lattice path. So then with Olga Postnova, in 2019, we studied character measures for generic H. Generic for SLN means none of the entries of this diagonal matrix are the same. So all HI and AJ are pairwise different. This is an analog of H strictly greater than zero for SL2. And then in the work that is about to be finished, hopefully, before the end of December, with Olga Postnova and Vera Sreganova. So we computed character measures for all H, even when H is non-generic. And in terms of representation theory, say for SS3, there is this principal vial chamber where all the highest weights of irreducible representations, irreducible finite dimensional representations are. So generic, when all entries of the diagonal matrix are pairwise different, means that our point H is inside of this vial chamber. Special means that it's on the wall or on some kind of deep stratum of the vial chamber. The extreme case is when H equals zero, that's the Plancherel case. So you can see between generic H and H equals zero, the Plancherel case, there is a whole variety of intermediate cases. So I don't think I'll go into this today, but I will explain how to derive this asymptotic for generic H. So, well, we use the standard tools of representation theory. We use the orthogonality of characters for SUN. The orthogonality of character means that the integral with respect to the Carr measure of this product of characters is the Kronecker symbol delta lambda nu and some weight numbers. And in terms of multiple integrals, it simply means that this multiple integral, where delta is the vial denominator, is equal to the Kronecker delta symbol. So here coordinates theta I are in this in the basis of coroutes, and doesn't matter. So if you will massage this formula a little bit, then you can see the orthogonality formula. Then you will have the following integral representation for the multiplicity of characters. And it's a multiple integral, so it's sort of with this factor character of nu to the power n. So this type of integrals are born to be computed by the steepest descent method as n goes to infinity. And this is exactly what we will do, except we'll also consider this case when lambda is proportional to n. And what's important is that xi is generic. If xi is not generic, the asymptotic of the multiplicity is different. So, so by evaluating this integral, you will get this formula. And again, the rate function S is just the Legendre transform of the log of the character of this representation nu that we're taking tensor power of. And this Legendre transform is very simple. It's determined by the critical point of the function. The function is strictly convex. So and I'm switching between convex and concave. So it's there is a unique solution to this equation. K is just the matrix of second derivatives of the rate function. And I keep saying rate function. So S is really the rate function in the usual sense of large deviation theory, but I don't think I have time for this. So this is step one. And step two, use this result in combination with the formula, Weyl formula for the characters. And then we have the similarly to the SL2 case, we have this kind of limit shape type behavior of the probability measure, of the character measure. So it's Gaussian on this scale, and it's exponentially small when xi is not equal to the limit shape. So again, it's this sharp Gaussian distribution near the limit shape eta. Okay, and then similarly we, to the SL2 case, we have the intermediate asymptotics. There are more of them because, you know, there are this there is this asymptotical behavior near the walls of the Weyl chamber. So the Plancherel measure, so this is more or less what Tate and Zeldich computed, and this is the general picture. So if H is generic, if it's strictly inside of the Weyl chamber, the critical point, this limit shape, the critical point of the rate function for the large deviation principle, it will be also strictly inside of the Weyl chamber. And then you will have a Gaussian distribution around this point, which is indicated by this red kind of disk. So then if H is non-generic, if it's on the wall, then, well, then again, there is a kind of, the critical point is, I made a mistake. The distribution naturally is around eta, not around H. I made it once, I erased it, and then I made it twice. So now it's correct. So the distribution is here. In the Plancherel case, the distribution is around the origin. And again, somewhere here there are, somewhere here there are these intermediate scalings. And then far away over there, there is a boundary. I didn't mention this, but in fact, there is a polytope where this probability is non-zero. It's zero outside of this polytope because simply those highest weights, they can never occur in this tensor product. And so over here, we have this asymptotical distribution when H goes to infinity. So this is all will come with in a joint work with Vera Serganova. It's coming and with Olga Vasnova. So thank you. This was, if you ask me why am I doing this, I'll tell you just because it's just such a fun to compute this asymptotics. There is no practical reason for this. It's just, it's a very nice game. It's like beats game.
Thank you, Kolya. Thank you for the nice talk. So you answered already one question you asked yourself. Are there any more questions? I see that Martin has a question. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for a nice and clear talk. I believe there's some interest, some literature on spin chains. On spin chains for non-compact spins. So in your context, that would prompt the question, can you do something similar for what's called holomorphic discrete series of non-compact Lie groups? You know, they are still discrete. So the mathematics shouldn't change too much. They still have highest weight or lowest weight. And I think if you take the tensor product of just all of them highest weight, then you should get similar structures like the one you have. You don't have Plancherel because the representations are infinite dimensional. But if you put on your magnetic field, then character exists, and I would expect that you can play another beautiful game. So have you thought in that direction?
No, I didn't think about this particular direction, but I completely agree that it's a good question. You know, the slight subtlety about infinite dimensional representations is that, strictly speaking, if you take the tensor product, you don't have the decomposition. You have the decomposition, but in a weak sense. Because, you know, in any reasonable space, you don't have actually direct, infinite direct sums. So, but in a weak sense, it exists. It's a totally correct question, and I guess somebody will have to do it. What I mean, we have a little project about the affine case. It's the same over there. You have the kind of integrable, irreducible representations. The characters are some combinations of theta functions. The question is, what will happen over there? It's work in progress. But for,
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Next question. So, Hiroshi Uguri.
Yeah, thank you very much, Koya. I really enjoyed your talk, very clear. And also, I appreciate your consideration to physicists. So my question is that, well, you briefly mentioned, but I wonder whether you have, is there any sort of suggestion on what happens if you introduce interactions between neighboring spins?
That's a really good
question. So far, all these spins are independent.
So, well, it depends on which question you want to ask. So again, if you introduce the interaction and you will study the kind of this type of character distributions, so I think it will be some kind of perturbation of the asymptotical distribution if the interaction is in some sense uniform between the various irreducible components.
Mm.
In other words, if the energy levels are not varying wildly between irreducible components. So what it means is that if you make this assumption, then you want probably yeah, then I would say that there is a distribution that depends on age, and then it's given by some complicated formula when the system is interacting. But when the magnetic field is increasing in such a way that it's much bigger than all the energy levels, then you can consider something like power series in e to the h. Or...
I see.
So there is some notion of perturbation theory over this entropic case.
Ah, I see. When the interaction is weak.
Yeah. When the interaction is weak, yes.
I see. Yeah. So I ask this because.
But not immediately. One should make some assumptions.
Yeah. I ask this because, well, so usually I don't mention my own work, but since you asked whether during your talk whether there is any physical result, so we have some work. About the sort of refinement of Cardi formula for conformal field theory, which includes the case with symmetry. And so classifying Cardi asymptotics into representations. So somehow the resulting formula is reminiscent of some of the formula you wrote. So I was curious about the case with interactions. Thank you.
Rush, if you could send me these references, this would be fantastic. Thank you. I'm sorry I missed them.
No. Since you just asked whether there is anything known in physics, so I just thought I should mention. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Nice. Thank you very much. Okay. There's another question on the chat from Tao Gui. Would you like to ask this question? Or so the question is, what do we know if we don't take limit.
Well, in some sense, we know everything in the sense that there is a formula for the distribution. If you want to compute any expectation values, you just use this formula. Presumably the best way is to, well, yeah, I think it's a silly question because
yes, it is described as such.
this is, you know, the best thing you can hope for is that for certain expectation values, there will be some explicit combinatorial formula. And sometimes it's very interesting. But you see, the beauty of the large N limit is that there is this uniform universal description. It doesn't matter which representations you're taking into tensor power, the description is kind of the same for all of them through this rate function and so on. You probably will not have it before taking the limit.
Okay, great. Any other questions?
I have a question about the non-generic case. Mm-hmm. Is the computation very different? Do you also use the saddle point method or is it different?
Well, we used the saddle point, the steepest descent method. I mean, it's really, yes. And the subtlety is that, well, I can tell you the answer. So the measure splits into the product. So in this case, you have the Cartan subalgebra corresponding to the Lie algebra that's on the boundary, let's say. So here is
hello. Is it just me or Kolya just dropped?
He's freezing.
Oh, Kolya. let's wait a bit for things to reset. Oops. Ah, not good. okay. Hello? Kolya, we don't hear you, but you're moving now, so that's good. Still don't hear you.
Kolya is muted.
You're on mute.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, sorry, you dropped when you were answering the question.
Yes, so basically I'll just say kind of on fingers how it works. So it's a product of two measures. The ones that, for the coordinates that are parallel to the boundary, it's the Plancherel measure for this Lie subalgebra G0 corresponding to the boundary. SL2 for the SL3 case. And it's a Gaussian measure in the directions that go inside of the well chamber. So it's just, and technicalities are very similar. It's just the computation of the steepest descent method, but slightly more sophisticated.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Any more questions, comments? I don't see any. Okay, so let's thank Kolya again.
Thank you.
And we can stop the recording.